I want to say, I know many of you have made it possible. Consider the Jewish Review of Books really centrally important today in the field. First of all, it's helped to unite the field. Today we have fragmented. Yes, the people who read American Jewish history don't read the Journal of Biblical Literature, and everybody reads the Jewish Review of Books. But more important even than that is it has helped to bridge the gap between the academy and the larger community of interested, intelligent Jews. Helping them to understand all sorts of books that they otherwise wouldn't be able to, and acquainting them with those books. And the most recent issue, which I recommend to all of you, has younger scholars, a graduate student, a young scholar. This is immensely important in helping not only to shape a new generation of scholars, but also to train them to write for that intelligent lay audience. And there's nothing more important, so it's really, they're wearing my Association for Jewish Studies president hat. I really want to thank you for all that you have done at the Jewish Review of Books. There are not so many journals that when they come in, I sit and read from cover to cover. The Jewish Review of Books, I always read. Really, congratulations for what you've made of it. It's remarkable. Now, we've just finished. We finished in April the 150th anniversary of the assassination of Abraham Lincoln. There were a whole lot of Abraham Lincoln books, including mine. And I recall that at one of those gatherings that as a teenager, my parents had brought us to Jerusalem and we were walking, and there, somehow close to streets named for Jewish luminaries, Peretz Smolensky, the Rambam, Moses Maimonides, there was a sign, you know, and you can see it in your package here, number two, a sign for Rehov, what the Israelis, of course, call Avraham Lincoln. I was just saying that on my way here on Friday, the Hebrew version of Lincoln and the Jews came, published by Devere, and Ben Chappell, my co-author, really had made the decision to spell the Hebrew of Lincoln without the second lamed, in order to teach Israelis that it's Lincoln and not Lincoln. But anyway, one day we were walking on this street, my late father and I, and my dad, who had a wonderful sense of humor, couldn't resist. So he stops a Haredi passerby. And he innocently asks him in Hebrew, who is this Avraham Lincoln? What did he do to merit such recognition, a street in Jerusalem? And the passerby stopped and he looked at the sign and he thought and he stroked his beard and then his eyes lit up and he replied, oh yes. He was a very prominent Jew from America. He made a large contribution to the United Jewish Appeal. So, fortunately, I don't have to identify Abraham Lincoln here, but still, lots of folks may wonder, Abraham Lincoln and the Jews, what's the relationship? How did Ben Chappell and I manage to fill almost 300 pages on that subject? And the answer turns out really to reveal a lot about Lincoln and about America and about the Jewish community of that time. It's worth remembering that Abraham Lincoln's life really coincided with the emergence of Jews on the American scene. He's born back in 1809, scarcely 3,000 Jews in the whole country, most of them concentrated in half a dozen East Coast port cities. By the time of Lincoln's assassination in 1865, you had had large-scale immigration, principally from Central Europe, that brought the Jewish population of the United States up to 150,000. So that's a pretty good jump. And so Lincoln's interactions with Jews really forms part of a much larger story. It's in microcosm the story of how America itself begins to come to terms with its growing Jewish population and how both Americans and Jews were changed by that encounter. Now, growing up in Hardin County, Kentucky, and Spencer County in Indiana, I didn't find any living Jews whom Abraham Lincoln encountered, and the only Jews we know that he was interested in were those whom he encountered in the Bible, which he mastered and knew thoroughly. Lincoln is arguably our most biblically literate president. It is astonishing. Those of you who get the book, we tried to notice where he was quoting the Bible, and you realize that he quotes obscure passages as well as well-known ones. This is the book that, you know, he had mastered growing up. It may have been the only book in some places, and he knew it backwards and forwards, and it just came naturally into his interactions and in his speeches. But he didn't know any live Jews. By 1850, however, Jews had, of course, spread from coast to coast. Literally, you had Jews by then in San Francisco, thanks to the gold rush. And Lincoln certainly, in the 1850s, encounters them. Lots of Americans likewise did. If you turn to the next page, you'll see, I'm sorry it didn't come out as well, but these are all the Jews whom Abraham Lincoln encountered at one time or another. There are 120 of them, friends, associates, supporters, acquaintances, and it's really the number that is astonishing. There isn't any previous president who comes close to simply encountering as many Jews as Lincoln did. And of course, lots of presidents, including Lincoln's predecessor, James Buchanan, and his successor, Andrew Johnson, were openly prejudiced against Jews. Easy to see that in their writings. Lincoln, by contrast, for half his life, has Jewish friends and acquaintances and intervenes on Jews' behalf. It's interesting, the Harvard social psychologist, political scientist Robert Putnam, has written about how when people have a diverse social network, it leads to a more positive assessment of specific religious groups, particularly those with low thermometer scores. What he's really saying is if you know people from a particular group that isn't popular, you're not as likely to share prejudices against that group. And that's certainly the case with Lincoln. He came to trust Jews, really, because he came to know Jews. Now, Lincoln was especially close to the man you can see on the next page here, whose name was Abraham Jonas. Abraham Jonas Originally, the family was a quite significant Orthodox family in England. His brother, Joseph Jonas, is really the first significant Jewish settler in Cincinnati. This Jonas, Abraham, is a Jewish lawyer and politician. He moves over to Quincy, Illinois, and he knows Abraham Lincoln for more than two decades, and we do possess in Lincoln's hand a dedication to Jonas, where he calls Jonas one of my most valued friends. Now, Lincoln said that about some other people, but that he said it about a Jew is remarkable. We have interesting letters between Lincoln and Jonas. Most of them deal with political strategy. Jonas had one of the best political minds in Illinois, and there's little doubt that Jonas, working behind the scenes, is trying to craft a new Republican Party strategy, and his idea was to focus on political outsiders. It's one of those moments you're reading letters and you sort of just jump back, because Jonas suggests that among the outsiders there should be, of course, liberals and free-thinking Germans, and then Israelites. And the notion that Israelites should be part of a thinking coalition. Of course, from then till now, the Republicans have been thinking about how to gain the Israelites, but that it shows you that Israelites are suddenly part of the community. Jonas also, if you turn on the next page, hosted Abraham Lincoln for one of the famous Lincoln-Douglas debates. You'll see the name A. Jonas at the bottom there. The one that was held in Quincy. And we also know that he was enormously important in 1860 at the Republican Convention. So this is the anniversary. The convention that year was held in what was then called the Wigwam, because it resembled a big Indian teepee in Chicago. And the way politics worked, different candidates used to try and pack the halls. Seward thought that he had the very best political machine, and he had printed up lots of tickets, which he handed out to his supporters, the idea being they would make an enormous noise when Seward was nominated. Everybody would say, well, it's in the bag for Seward. He'll be nominated on the first ticket, on the first ballot. And Jonas heard about this. He said, well, two can play that game. And he rounded up a lot of Lincoln supporters and got them in. And if you actually go back to the convention, you'll see that they have, you know, adjectives about Seward and a great resounding rally. And then when Lincoln is nominated, the same thing happens. And that, of course, suggested to people that it wasn't so clearly in the bag for Abraham Lincoln. And the strategy was that if they would abandon Seward on the first ballot, abandon their first love on the first ballot, they might all turn to Lincoln as their second love, which in fact happens, and he wins on the third ballot. But it's had not been as well known that behind the scenes orchestrating a lot of that was his friend Abraham Jonas. And so it's no surprise, there are a lot of other letters from Jonas, no surprise that when Lincoln becomes president, the very first Jew whom he appoints to public office is Abraham Jonas, whom he appointed postmaster. In those days, that was very lucrative, a patronage position, because you could appoint other people under you, which Jonas did. And what's interesting and shows us something about the friendship is that when Jonas died, Lincoln unusually appointed his wife, Louisa, to succeed Abraham Jonas, showing his high regard for the family. And there's actually a document where she's appointed postmistress. That sounds like something else, but it's appointed there, and she filled out the term. You know, he appoints, and if you go back to that chart, he appoints a variety of other Jews, especially with the onset of war. Not clear whether he knew all of them were Jewish. And then you come to this remarkable letter, which you have, dated November the 4th, 1862, where we see Lincoln purposefully appointing a Jew. "I believe we have not yet appointed a Hebrew." And he then goes on. He seems to be writing it Shiri. The man's name was Nehemiah, and short for Chemi, which is how he was known in the Jewish community. But you find other documents where he has this French name. And he writes, you know, "We haven't appointed a Hebrew. Here's a man who's appointed because he is a Jew." Probably the first case of affirmative action for Jews in all of American Jewish history. This Chemi Levi is the son-in-law of Rabbi Morris Raphael of B'nai Jeshurun. Morris Raphael was an Orthodox rabbi. B'nai Jeshurun in those days was an Orthodox congregation. Raphael is actually remembered, and there is a certain irony. Raphael is actually remembered for a sermon he gave in which he suggested that slavery was sanctioned by the Bible. But we forget that when Lincoln is actually in office, Raphael strongly supports the Union, and one of his sons was wounded in the Civil War, and this is his son-in-law. Chemi Levi was Orthodox. And now if you go back to the letter, you will see this is vintage Lincoln wordplay. He says he is well vouched as a capable and faithful man. And of course, that's a double meaning of faithful. He's faithful because he's Orthodox, unlike most of these other folks whom he appointed, and he's faithful to the Union. So he's faithful in two senses. And Lincoln appoints him quartermaster. Quite a few Jewish quartermasters in the Civil War, partly because a merchant, and a lot of Jews were merchants, a merchant has the skills to do the organizing. The quartermaster was the man who was in charge of finding quarters and food and all these necessities for the army. And many Jews had the necessary skills. Lincoln made a much more important appointment of a Jew at around that time. This one literally changes the course of American history. We do not appreciate always its significance. And that is that he appoints the first Jewish military chaplain. Now, when the Civil War begins and Congress has to write appropriations for the Civil War, so Congress creates this military chaplaincy in a much more formal way. And by law, it restricts the chaplaincy to, quote, "regularly ordained ministers of some Christian denomination." There was at least one senator who recognized that that would leave Jews out. Most of the senators thought everybody's a Christian of one sort or another. What was interesting to them was that you had to be regularly ordained, because In previous cases, there had been all sorts of fly-by-night ministers who were on the public payroll, and this aimed to prevent it. But it has to be some Christian denomination. They took that very seriously. And remember, you have by now thousands of Jews who are in the Union Army. The standard number is 7,000, the Union Army. And one of the units which had a significant number of Jews in it, in those days the regiments would elect a chaplain, and they elect Reverend Arnold Fischel, this man, to be their chaplain. And it must have been very uncomfortable, because it goes all the way up to the Secretary of War, Simon Cameron. And Simon Cameron reads the law and has to tell Fischel, who, by the way, was much more intelligent, better educated, and all the necessary equipment, more than many of the other chaplains, but he writes him a letter, a nice letter. You are respectfully informed that the chaplain must be a regular ordained minister of some Christian denomination. Had it not been for this legal impediment, the department would have taken your application into its favorable consideration. So think about that. Had that continued, Jews would be a second-class religion in the United States, legally barred from serving as chaplains, and it meant the Jewish soldiers didn't have the benefit of guidance from a Jewish chaplain. And so Fischel resolves, well, I guess Jews do that in their day as well, to speak truth to power. He's going to lead a battle for Jewish equality. The Board of Delegates of American Israelites, which was an early organization of Jews, backs him. We have a lot of documents right here at the Center for Jewish History about it. And Fischel decides the only way this is going to happen is if he goes straight up to Abraham Lincoln. Which he decides to do. He seems to have informed a few people because when he comes to the White House, those of you who saw the film, it was quite accurate, Spielberg's film on Lincoln. You know, there was always all sorts of people outside Lincoln's office. But if Lincoln knew you were coming, or if you had informed the right people, he let you in. And actually, Lincoln had a special affinity and respect for ministers. Fischel would certainly have worn a collar, as most rabbis also did in those days. And he is admitted, and he gives us in his firsthand report that the president looked at his documents, fully admitted the justice of my remarks, and agreed that something ought to be done. And so Lincoln works with Congress. In those days, the president worked with Congress sometimes. And it's not easy, because when you have a law that seems to privilege Christians, it's not so easy to figure out how you're going to undo that. Imagine having to tell your constituents that you're doing it. So I was reading it while we were in one of our periodic deadlocks, and I said, boy, I wish we had a Lincoln today. Lincoln decides very quickly that he's not going to change these words. Instead, they pass an amendment to construe the word Christian to mean religious. That, of course, solves the problem. But they're still kind of worried about it. So they then take that amendment and they bury it very deep, so deep, I'm the first person who found it, because today you can search electronically. Even the great Bert Korn never found it. They buried it deep in a bill. that gave raises to America's most popular generals. No senator votes against raises to popular generals in wartime. The bill with that amendment passes, and then Lincoln makes it happen immediately. Within days, he appoints the first Jewish chaplain, a man named Jacob Frankel, and at that moment, American history was changed, because what it meant was that non-Christians of every sort could serve in the military chaplaincy. So today, when they're Muslim chaplains, we even have a Wiccan chaplain, it all goes back, really, to this moment in the Civil War when the chaplaincy was broadened by the Battle of Arnold Fischel and then the appointment of Jacob Frankel. It's really interesting because 1862 is a time when Lincoln is dealing a lot with Jewish matters. He also meets another Jew. As Abe noted, I'm interested in these curious Jewish figures who pop up, and none is more curious than the man on the next page, whose name is Issachar Zachary, often known as Dr. Zachary. Those who read Lincoln books will often find a stray reference to this Zachary. One historian called him Abraham Lincoln's most enigmatic intimate. I don't know whether one would want to be an enigmatic intimate, but what's very significant is that he was a podiatrist. The 19th century term is chiropodist. And of course, he was a Jew. First of all, I learned an enormous amount about Jews and chiropody. I was very grateful to our university library. It's not such a big library. It got me everything on the history of chiropody, which I had no idea. It turned out largely to have been Jews who developed that branch of medicine, partly because doctors looked down on it, and therefore Jews who were looked down upon could enter that branch of medicine. Feet problems, of course, were much more common than now. It's amazing how recently it has been discovered that well-fitting shoes prevent feet problems. Left shoe, right shoe, all of that was unknown as recently as the 19th century. You could all go home and do an experiment. Put your left foot on your left foot into your right shoe and your right foot into your left shoe, and you'll need a chiropodist as well. Abraham Lincoln's feet, of course, were known to be particularly troublesome and painful. There is a big dispute among the scholars over whether he had particular Morfan syndrome. I may have mispronounced that, whether he had that syndrome, didn't have it, or had something else. But in any case, he had famously painful feet. And Issachar Zachary, before the Civil War, was known as one of the greatest chiropodists in the United States. Nobody knows how he learned it, but he was very, very skillful. And he was a clever man, so each time he cured your feet, he asked for a testimonial. And those testimonials, hundreds of them survive. They're owned by Ben Chappelle. And you can see Henry Clay says nice things, and John Calhoun, and all sorts of people wrote testimonials. And so eventually, and I tell the whole story in the book, but eventually he's recommended to Abraham Lincoln. He comes to see Abraham Lincoln at the White House. Lincoln's feet are naturally painful. If you turn to the next page, you'll see, amazing, the man had so much chutzpah, but he asks Abraham Lincoln for a testimonial. And Lincoln, being Lincoln, writes it. But, and this, by the way, September 20th, 1862, that's just about the time that Lincoln has decided to emancipate the slaves. It's not like he has nothing else to do all day and he said, let's write a testimonial. But in any case, he writes this, and this is vintage Lincoln. It's worth reading. Dr. Zachary has with great dexterity taken some troublesome corns from my toes. He is now healing me, and I believe with success, for what plain people call backache. We shall see how it will end. I mean, this is wonderful. It's brief. It's to the point. It associates him with plain people, which Lincoln did. And it's honest, really almost honest to a fault. As a professor, I have to write all sorts of recommendations. No doubt you do too. I assure you, I never would write, oh, we shall see how he will end. I don't think that would get someone a job. But, you know, Lincoln, Honest Abe, writes honestly. And as you see in the one next down, a couple of days later, Zachary is back and he's operated my feet, and kind of Lincoln is more positive, and so on. We now know that Lincoln and Zachary met on multiple occasions, and astonishingly, Lincoln sends Zachary to New Orleans. New Orleans has been recaptured by the Union, and he sends him there essentially as a spy, but also to help win people back to the Union. And what does Lincoln say? He also, to provide intelligence and, quote, as a means of access to his countrymen who are quite numerous. It turns out, if you look at how Lincoln refers to Jews, countrymen are Jews, even though they didn't have a country. He is trying to find an ethnic designation for Jews. The word people didn't exist, Jews didn't call it. He's not going to call them members of his race. So his countrymen refers to Jews. And actually, it makes perfect sense. Louisiana had very, very significant Jews, of course. Judah Benjamin is the one who comes to mind, who was by then Secretary of State of the Confederacy, but had been the Jewish senator from Louisiana. But actually, the whole leadership of Louisiana consisted of people. It's a bit like the election now. They're not Jewish themselves, but they have Jewish relatives. And so it was in Louisiana in the same way. And there were very wealthy and significant Jews there. And we know that Zachary spent his time in part helping those Jews. And he tried to help Jews who ran afoul of the authorities, which Jews would call Pidyon Shvuyim, rescuing, freeing the captives. And he is indeed much later and somewhat secretly honored by the Jewish community for that work. And then, like a lot of people in the Civil War, they were sure, we have such people today, they're sure, leave it to me, I'll make peace in a few minutes. And so Zachary gets involved in trying to make peace. And I really, the most amazing, and it's one of the most amazing letters, is that Zachary Lincoln gives him a pass to the South, and he actually meets Judah Benjamin. See, I mean, for people who think there's a Jewish conspiracy, here's Zachary, the Jew, meeting Judah Benjamin, the Jew. Zachary writes a strange letter to Benjamin that could be interpreted in different ways. Of course, like all the other peace initiatives at that time. It failed, but it is extraordinary as a moment. Then Zachary comes back, and Lincoln puts him to work on his reelection campaign, and Zachary's job is to get Jews to vote for Lincoln. Lincoln, of course, is very worried that he's not going to get reelected in 1864. And as far as I know, this is the first kind of Jewish get-out-the-vote campaign that we have in American Jewish history, a sign that the Republican probably exaggerated the number of Jewish voters. That's true from that day to this day. We have this letter. I mean, you read sometimes letters in this period, and you're just amazed. Zachary writes to Lincoln, "As regards the Israelites, with but few exceptions, they will vote for you. I have secured good and trustworthy men to attend on them on election day." 1864, astonishing, really. Now, Jews had many good reasons to vote for Lincoln in 1864. Not only had he appointed Jews to office, but he had refused to heed anti-Semites who blamed Jews for wartime smuggling, and he had unhesitatingly overturned Ulysses S. Grant's infamous order, General Orders Number 11, expelling Jews as a class from his war zone. If I had been Spielberg, I would have smuggled Lincoln's statement into the movie. Lincoln said, it's still timely today, "To condemn a class is, to say the least, to wrong the good with the bad. I do not like to hear a class or nationality condemned on account of a few sinners." I wish that had somehow gotten into the film. It's a good message. I actually think this was probably the most controversial assertion in the book. But I think that Lincoln actually changes his official rhetoric to make America somewhat more inclusive. Yes, we're talking about how Jews move from outsiders to insiders. If you look at Lincoln's first inaugural address, he does refer to Christianity as if all Americans are Christian. And there are several other Christological references in early presidential statements. And Jews protested. And in fact, there's a significant Jewish letter to Lincoln when he puts out a rather Christological statement urging the soldiers to observe Sunday and so on. And I think Lincoln is sensitized, and that's why in the Gettysburg Address, where, of course, Jews and Christians have fallen side by side, and that was known that they both fell at Gettysburg, and Lincoln invents this new term. Even though Edward Everett, in his endless talk at Gettysburg, does refer to Christianity over and over and over and turns it to a Christological event, that's not what Lincoln does. Instead, he says, "This nation under God." That's a very significant phrase, not only because it's later in the Pledge of Allegiance, but because it's inclusive language from a Jewish perspective. Jews are now insiders. And even in Lincoln's second inaugural, which is one of the masterful address, one of the great speeches ever given, the greatest inaugural addresses, and in a way it's a sermon, but it's not a Christological sermon. It is a sermon addressed to people of all faiths, and Lincoln really is mostly quoting the Hebrew Bible, what he would have called the Old Testament, when he makes biblical quotes there. So, you know, even there, I think Lincoln helps broaden us out. I'm going to move to Lincoln's last week of life because that is much more than we realize, close, almost eerily closely connected with the Jewish community. The surrender at Appomattox Courthouse, which is really the demise of slavery, occurred one day before Jews sat down to the Passover Seder. And that was noted at the time. It's not just a later historian notes it. So in my neck of the woods in Boston, the Daily Advertiser pointed to, quote, the coincidence that the modern people of bondage, meaning Southern slaves, have seen their deliverance confirmed and nearly consummated about the same season of the year as Passover. And then 2 days later, when Jews are sitting down to the second Seder, Lincoln then gives his last public address. The subject of that last address was post-war Reconstruction. It's the address in which Lincoln talks about black suffrage and urges that at least the very intelligent and those who are serving in the ranks of soldiers be able to vote. And we know that John Wilkes Booth, he's very handsome, so I gave you a picture, was in the audience. And it's now disputed that he said it, but according to legend, John Wilkes Booth mutters, "Now by God, I'll put him through. That is the last speech he will ever make." That Friday, all the books report that that Friday was Good Friday, which is indeed correct. None of the books report that that Friday night was Erev Shabbat Chol HaMoed. It was Friday night of the intermediate days of Passover. And as Jews are sitting down to dinner, Lincoln and his entourage famously travel to Ford's Theater. And everybody knows what happens next. I invite you to look at Alonzo Chappell's famous painting. I want you to look at this painting for two reasons. Number one, it's extremely interesting. Have any of you been in the room where Lincoln was laid out in Washington? It's a narrow, small room. The problem was dozens of people claimed to have been with Abraham Lincoln on his last hours. So poor Alonzo Chappell had to extend the room to get them all in. And essentially, and that's why that room looks like this room, a reminder of the dangers and difficulties of trying to create historical reality. It's absolutely impossible that all these people were in that room. There wouldn't have been any room for poor Lincoln. But the second thing I wanted you to see is this man in the middle, right over Lincoln. We now know, it's new in our book, that that man is a Jewish doctor. His name was Charles H. Lieberman. It turned out from Russia, a very significant doctor who was head of the Medical Association in Washington at that time, which is exactly why he was the one who pronounced Lincoln dead. And he was he according to the tradition poured brandy down Lincoln's throat and tried to see what he could do, but realized that the bullet was fatal. And there actually are some documents that again. Amazingly, Ben Chappelle was able to acquire, which relate to this doctor, Dr. Lieberman. So the point of this is, do you have any other? I guess we lost a picture or two. It's all right. You could get the book, but this painting of Chappell with including Dr. Lieberman really serves as a kind of timely reminder that Jews, even then, formed an integral part of the history of the United States. Even though there are not so many Jews today who had ancestors living at the time of the Civil War. Anybody here have Civil War ancestors? So you see what I mean. My wife did. But those Jews who were in the United States at the time of the Civil War, like Carvalho and Jonas and Zachary and so many others in the book, they participated actively in the history of their time. It's very important to me that my students at Brandeis know, and that really all Jews know, that American history is not just somebody else's history. Contemporary Jews need to own that history, and Jews have been part of the history. And I guess Lincoln and the Jews, the book, formed part of that effort. So I'll stop there. Thank you very much. I'm happy to take questions. Anything you always wanted to know about American Jewish history, this is a great opportunity. Please.
What was the year of General Order 11?
General Order number 11 is December of 1862. And if those who are interested, I actually did a different book called When General Grant Expelled the Jews, which is all about that order. That book actually led to Lincoln. People wonder. I'd never met Ben Chappelle, and he heard me give a talk on that Grant book, and then came to see me and said, I've got these amazing documents. We've got to, you know, you got to help me turn them into a book. And even though I thought I was done with the Civil War, when I saw those documents, many of which have never been seen, I said, got to be a book here. And then, of course, we realized if you're going to do a book for the 150th anniversary of the assassination. That was probably, and it forced us to work much faster than we might otherwise have done, but it all paid off and the book came out, and that's kind of how we got from Grant to this book. Yeah.
Were the Jews of that time widely aware of the General Order 11 story?
That's a really interesting, I mean, all the Jewish newspapers, without exception, print a lot about it. So anyone who read the Occident, the Israelite, the Jewish Messenger, and so on, knew the story. So I'll tell you one other thing since you're asking. I recently found a document, not in the book, sometimes you get documents later, just surfaced, which is a Jewish broadside urging Jews to vote for Lincoln in 1864, not from Zachary. And the amazing thing is they give reasons to vote for Lincoln, but they don't mention either the chaplaincy or General Orders number 11, which would have been the obvious things to mention. Instead, they point to kind of general things that Lincoln had done in terms of importance of the war and so on. I'm not sure whether this is simply an effort to be universalistic and not wanting to suggest that Jews should vote for Lincoln for, God forbid, for particularistic reasons of their own, or whether, as you have implied, maybe it wasn't as well known as it would be later that Grant expelled the Jews. It's very hard for a historian to figure out why some is not there. But since you asked the question, even though all the newspapers reported it, and you know, it may be that that document suggests not all the Jews knew it, and they therefore pointed to other reasons to vote for Lincoln. Yeah.
At this point in time, have any Jews been elected to Congress? And if so, has their Jewish background been an issue?
It's a great question. There are, by of course, Benjamin himself is in the Senate, and you have Jewish congressmen. There is a book on all the, by a man named Stone, Kurt Stone, on, I think it came out in two editions. One was called The Congressional Minion. I think the other was called The Jews of Capitol Hill, maybe. By then, some of them didn't know what a minion was. And you have Jews in Congress, some of them people of Jewish descent, and you know, some of them self-affirming Jews already in the 1840s, not a lot, very small number. There is not, I mean, you do have elections earlier where someone's Judaism becomes an issue. In the 1820s, the leading American Jew of the day and the first major Jew in politics, whose name was Mordecai Noah, some of you know that name because he had an idea for setting up a Jewish colony called Ararat in Grand Island near the mouth of the Erie Canal near Buffalo, New York. But Mordecai Noah ran for sheriff of New York, and there was a great deal of anti-Semitism. People said if you have a Jewish sheriff, you might have a case of a Jew hanging a Christian, to which Noah is supposed to have replied, what kind of a Christian needs to be hung at all? And which was a good answer, but Noah lost the election anyway. But you don't have a lot. There are interesting cases under Lincoln. Lincoln appoints, it's in the book, a man as a, he's really only of Jewish descent, and none of the Jews considered him Jewish because he'd been baptized. But he appoints him as minister to one of the Swiss cantons, and the Swiss explode against having a Jew. From their perspective, the fact that he was baptized didn't matter. The fact that he had a Jewish last name and was of Jewish descent mattered a lot. And they make a lot of noise, and Lincoln has to transfer him to Sweden there. So you had some cases, but and there certainly is anti-Semitism. You have generals who are deeply anti-Semitic. Not just Grant, Sherman has very nasty things to say, and you have other Butler nasty things to say. And yet it is clear that there were Jews who were elected on their merit, which is what the founders would have wanted there. And of course, that's going to be more true as we move on. Please, yeah. Oh, thank you.
Thank you. I was thinking when you really reach the level of an Abraham Lincoln and you think of the slavery and what he had, this, you're really showing the greatness of this man.
Hmm.
Brilliance and political.
And it was all part of a piece, meaning, I didn't get into that, but since you raise it, to his mind, if you were broad-minded and you had to support oppressed people, you support blacks and you support Jews. And those were the two examples of oppressed people in the 19th century, and even a certain amount where people looked at plays about Jews and said, oh, this could be about blacks and vice versa. They were linked in the public mind as the two great oppressed groups. I'm sorry, you had a question though, yeah.
And then I want to ask you something that's so silly. In the Constitution, the Establishment Clause, the separation of church and state, I know this sounds ridiculous, but did anybody fall back on that, or is this?
Yes.
We have it today?
It's a good question. It's a very good question. The question is, how on earth do we have military chaplains when there's a no Establishment Clause? Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof. Why do we establish chaplains? No less than Isaac Mayer Wise, the great Reform rabbi who we would today say was a strict separationist, he agreed with you. Instead of having a Jewish chaplain, said he, there shouldn't be any chaplains. But the tradition went the other way for the obvious reason that if I am inducting people into the army, then I've got to take care of them. In other words, by virtue of the fact that I am requiring them to come into the army, I have to meet their religious needs. And so in a sense, the free exercise clause takes over. And that one. Now, your question is so good that it eventually went up to the Supreme Court. In the 20th century, the chaplain, I forget, maybe somebody here remembers the name of the case. The chaplaincy is challenged. You know, in our time, and the lawyer is still with us, and a Jewish lawyer, not Nate Lewin, but another Jewish lawyer who was a military man of great repute and actually great learning. He wrote some work on the Ramban as well. He argued the case for the military of why there needed to be chaplains. Drazen is his name, Drazen, D-R-A-Z-I-N, and he won. And the chaplaincy won, and that established in law, it doesn't just apply to the chaplaincy, it applies in jail. If the government, I don't recommend it, but if the government puts you in jail, there are chaplains in jail, and you can get kosher food in jail and so on, because you do not lose your right to freedom of religion when the government coerces you to do something. And for that reason, the free exercise clause wins out. I used to say trumped, but now I'm told I can't use that word. The free exercise clause wins, and the establishment clause is seen by the courts as less important. I'm not a lawyer, but you can go and look up that. It's a great question. I'm going back and forth here. Yes?
Outside of his immersion in the Bible, was Lincoln attracted to or interested in Judaism as a set of beliefs and principles and laws?
You know, that's a harder question, how much he really knew about Judaism. I think that Lincoln has deep theological questions, and that's perfectly clear in his second inaugural when he's trying to figure out how does God allow for the carnage of the Civil War? And as you remember, the only solution he can come up with is that it's punishment for slavery and so on. And if you remember the Spielberg film, it ends with Lincoln wishing that he could go to the Holy Land after his presidency. Now, there is a dispute among the scholars how seriously to take that. It comes from a line that Mary Lincoln, his widow, wrote after the assassination. Some people say it reflects Mary more than Abraham. I do not agree. I think Lincoln had real theological questions, and people who had real theological questions in the 19th century often believed, I'll go to Jerusalem, and there I will be able to find answers to my theological questions. Thanks to the steamboat, it had become much easier to travel to the Holy Land, and of course, Seward and Grant do go there. So I don't see any reason why Lincoln, had he lived, and it is in the book, I agreed to have it in the book, shouldn't have wanted to go to the Holy Land, and I think he had theological issues. I don't think that he could have gotten up and given a very serious discussion of what distinguished Jews from Christians, Jewish thought, and the like, but he must have learned something from talking to Abraham Jonas, who did come from a family that knew about Judaism. And although Jonas himself had strayed, He has one meeting with Lincoln in an oyster bar. Jonas's brothers are founders of a synagogue in Quincy and remain quite observant. And Joseph Jonas also does in Cincinnati. So, you know, but it's all conjecture what they shared with one another.
From a political point of view, were the Jews more associated with the large wave of German immigration that came to this country in the 1840s and had an influence on political? Mm-hmm.
Well, the vast majority of Jews are the Jews who are coming from Central Europe. Some come from German land, some come from Polish land, and then you have smaller numbers, Holland, England, and even some from Eastern Europe. Now, Jewish history, because of the nature of America, we tend to remember those who came as refugees. And there were some who had to escape after the failed 1848 revolutions. Yes, as you saw this weekend, people who wage revolutions that are unsuccessful have to get out quickly or their fate is not happy. So there were certainly people who came then. And some of those 1848ers, even if they came a little later, were the most likely to be anti-slavery and because it fit in with their general liberalism, to fit in with Lincoln's ideology. But of course, the vast majority of Jews, as the vast majority of immigrants all the time, are people also coming for opportunity reasons. And it's not easy to separate those two. Jews faced all sorts of restrictions in Central Europe. And depending on where you were, some of the fiercest restrictions, which were new in the 19th century, such as in Bavaria, sought to limit Jewish marriages, because the idea was we don't want any more Jews than we have. And the only way to make sure that happens is not to allow Jews to marry, said they, and then they won't multiply. And so there were actually quite serious restrictions on marriage, and you can imagine that that was a serious spur to emigration for young people as well. So there were all sorts of reasons people came, but without having done a quantitative survey, it seems to me that those whom Lincoln was closest to were real kind of liberals who opposed the European monarchies, like classical liberals, and who were sympathetic to his views. Please, yeah.
Lincoln had probably the most sophisticated and major commercial law practice in Illinois.
Mm-hmm.
Was he getting referrals, or did he practice with either clients who were Jewish or referral sources who were Jewish?
I talk in the book about a couple of Jews. Now, it's very hard to know. He doesn't say, I'm defending ye Jew, as they might have in colonial. So there's no mention of Jews. On the other hand, people knew who was Jewish in the 19th century. It's not like today. If you were Jewish, your neighbors knew, it was talked about, and so on. So he certainly had Jewish clients. Only now are they putting Lincoln's legal records, online and work. So I expect that more work will be able to be done on that and to figure out how many clients were, and we viewed what we did as preliminary, but I used that material. I think we've got four whom we know of, some of them related to one another, which makes sense, because, I had this great lawyer and so on, and he had them, but, and you know, he also interacted with Jonas, who was a lawyer, and these guys would be on the road all the time, and that's where they saw each other, yeah.
Observation that if you're representing a client, you really do develop a unique unique relationship with other counsel. It's a, you get to know people in a different way from the way you would if you were.
Interesting. I think that's a fair comment, and there's no question that he had interactions with Jewish clients, Jewish witnesses, and the reason disproportionately so is so many Jews were merchants, and merchants tend to have more court cases simply. Right, and that's what he did, and therefore, as you have more and more Jews, they more or less monopolize the clothing trade, and the clothing trade is really burgeoning in this period. Of course, the Civil War is going to do a lot to help that as well, and he knew these clothing dealers, and I'm inclined to agree with you. In some cases, he knew them as lawyer-client relations. So thank you very much.